Long piece of rope. In fact, how about a couple of girls? Who wants to come up and help me? Go there. Oh, okay, young fella, come on. Just a young lady, come on. Okay, come on up here. You get to this end, young lady, over there. And you step right over here, okay? Now, what we have here is a piece of rope with two ends, one on each. So just a moment, we'll come down about the middle, find the center. So we'll take it, we'll pull it all up here, till we get to the center. All right, and that should be close enough to the center. But you hold on to that rope, and you hold on to that. There you go. Because what, stretch it out a little bit here. Stretch out, back up, make it look like a big act, okay? Well, I'll hold it here, and that should be about close enough to the middle there, I think, okay? We'll cut it there. No, I think we're gonna need a little off of this end here. No, that wouldn't make it right there. We've got to take some from here, maybe some from there, maybe some from here, and maybe a little bit about there, and one there. Now, what's the magic word? That's right. Don't tell them how we did it. Will you please? You didn't see that? Come here, I'll show you again. Come on over here, come on in close. Now what we're gonna do, we take the two ends here, and we'll come down to about there. That should be close enough to the center, right? All right, we'll cut it in about there. Is that fair? All right, we'll put this here. You roll that in there, young lady. You roll that one. Now what we're gonna do is tie it together here, and we'll tie it all back in a nice hard knot here, and that should be. But wait a minute, first not close enough to the center here, is it? I think you have more rope than she has. We ought to get this pretty close to the center. Maybe about the center there, don't you think? Is that, well, now you have too much rope. Now we'll bring it down there. Is that about right? Well, you don't have much rope left, do you? I'll tell you, here, you take the knots out there, and we'll put it out back. Don't tell him how we did that, will you? Thank you, young lady. Okay, dear. Okay. I have a little trick up here, if I may. I'm going to need somebody out there. I need some older person, please. The boy back there, would you come right up, please? And do we have another older boy? Yeah, the boy here. Come right on up. Come right on up here, if you will. Oh, boy, I don't know. I took a couple of guys, huskies, up here. But I'll tell you what we're going to do. May I take off my coat? Would you about them? Mind if I take the coat off, because for this it's a little strenuous, and I'll just place it here. And if you would be so kind as to hold on to that lock key, and would or hear me, keep that lock key, do not lose it, or I'm a dead man. Hold that one. I'll take off the rings and the utilities here, because we have a cover. If I could be undressed, I should have. Okay. All right, we'll take this. Would you put that around, put the crew in lock it? All right, lock it tight. Okay, and now if you would lock that around my arm. You're down. You got it? Okay, lock that. There, all right, we're in a good tight. Okay, good luck. Okay, we're in a good tight. Now, if you would hold on to that corner with your this other hand, and you hold on with this hand, that's right, spread out over here. Now, we're in a good tight. Now, would you take that hand and hold it about here, right here, and your hand right about there. Now, what we want to do is, well, your hand wants you to get a little bit there. Now, here, right there. Now, what we want your hand to carry is, like you see, well, no, your hands should come down a little lower. Like that.
To be back in Mississippi. As you know, I don't get to be in Mississippi much. I'm traveling constantly for a year. I have about 5 or 6 days off at Christmas and about 8 days off at Easter. That's it. I live out of a suitcase and I live in every hotel in the United States. So it's good to be back in Mississippi. I'm 21-year-old daughter of Dorothy Little and Harry Little of Meridian. And I live in Meridian. And it's so good to be here. So good to be around Mississippians and to see you all. And a lot of people tell me when I go around the United States, they tell me you've lost your southern accent. I sort of lost it myself because when I started in school, I started in broadcasting, I said I wasn't going to sound like I was from the South. But every time when I come home, I can understand everyone. When I go everywhere else like the United States, I can't understand people. But when I get back and I hear that southern talk, I know that I'm home. Good to be here.
That we've had coming out and seeing Susan and welcoming her home. She's a dear friend of mine, but I tell you, I've said this several times, I get to stay here in Mississippi and see all of you people and do a lot of things. She gets to travel all around the country, but I'm not complaining one bit. I am from Hattiesburg, a native Mississippian. I go to USM. I'm a junior majoring in communications and minoring in marketing, so I can understand your job as a public relations and Susan, so maybe that helps as Miss Mississippi. I always shop at Jenny Jungle, I might say that too. But I'm very proud to be here. It's a lovely festival. I invite you all to participate in all the activities and hang around. It's going to be a great day, and thank you all for coming.
Hi, good morning. After following these two, I thought I should bring a cane or a crutch to come out because I'm the married one. I am married to Richard Stump Russell, who is an Ole Miss Rebel. My children, though, want to go to state. So we're going to have a divided family pretty soon. I do have two children, Heather and Jason, and I'm very fortunate to get to stay in the state of Mississippi as well as travel. It's wonderful to be home. It's wonderful to see each one of you. I can't wait for the autograph session to get to meet you personally. We're going to have a good time today, and I plan on seeing you over at the autograph booth. Thank you.
Okay, we have a few minutes to kill here. They asked me to come up here and ask the ladies some questions, and I couldn't think of any questions, so I started Mississippi. When you became first alternate for Susan Aiken, did you have any idea she would become Miss America?
That girl? No way. No, it really did, you know, the excitement of course, the Miss Mississippi pageant, you know, you're just sort of caught up in that moment, you know, you weren't really looking. And when Susan was crowned Miss Mississippi, and she turned to me, and we are very close friends, and she always says what she feels and says what she means. And she looked over there, she said, I hope you're ready to take this crown in a few months. And I said, go for it. And of course it worked, so I have no quarrels with that whatsoever.
Thank you. Now the next question I have, and this is a question I could ask each of you, so just step up and give your answer to, what was your talent in the pageant? What did you do for the talent competition?
We didn't have to have talent in our pageant. My talent was being from Mississippi.
That's plenty of talent right there.
And in Miss Mississippi and Miss America, I sang. And when I was in Miss America, I sang an Italian love song. Was You're My World.
And I, too, tried to sing also. I sang a Barbara Streisand song from the movie A Star Is Born. It was called Woman in the Moon. It worked, I guess.
The next question could be for all of you again. What areas of competition in your pageant were the hardest and which were the most fun? I told you that'd be tough questions, didn't I?
I feel like I'm on a game show. You know, they ask you a trivia show. They ask you a question, you all stand up, you get a chance at it. The most difficult, I try to look at every part of the pageant on an even scale, and I don't try to think of it any part being difficult. It was all fun to me. My nerves were sky high, but it was all fun to me, every phase of competition, but the most exciting was interview. I performed magic on the side, and I got to perform a magic trick and interview, and it was fun to go into a room, was a room of celebrities, well-known celebrities that are on TV and do things around the United States. And it was fun to go in there and get to see them, get to talk to them, and get to know them. So the interview was the most exciting.
Hey, who else would like to handle that? It's totally optional. You can pass if you'd like to.
Being a first-time contestant in any pageant such as the Miss Mississippi pageant, I guess all of them just really blew my mind, and it was a lot of fun preparing for them. But I think Susan can agree with me on this. Susan and I had quite a lot of fun preparing for the swimsuit. If any of you caught the Star magazine in the Saran wrap deal, I think she and I both had the most fun doing that.
Does anybody in the audience, by the way, have a question you'd like to ask? Raise your hand if you have one. Mrs. America didn't answer? Well, we're not letting her off the hook that easy, are we? Step right up. Come on, the others were on the spot. It's your turn.
The hardest part of my pageant was after my husband, Stump, got to Reno, Nevada. He flew into Memphis, and they had canceled the flight into San Francisco, so they just flew him direct into Reno, Nevada around 11:30 that night. When he arrived, he did not have any bag at all. So between midnight that night and 8 o'clock the next morning when we started to film the pageant, we had to find him a tuxedo to wear in order to be in the pageant. So we called all around in the hotel, and finally there was one of the doormen upstairs in the Hilton Hotel restaurant that had a tuxedo, an extra one. And he went home and got it, and my husband tried it on about 2:45 that morning and wore the tuxedo of the doorman at the Hilton. So I think that was the hardest thing. The most exciting part was flying back into Mississippi and coming back home to greet my friends. It's great to win a crown, and it's great to win a title, but you're in another state away from friends and family. So the greatest thing was flying back into Jackson.
Is there anyone out here who would like to ask a question? Just raise your hand and I'll come to you. Anyone that would like to ask a question? Any burning question on your mind that you'd like to ask one of these ladies? There's somebody. Hold on. Y'all stay right here. I'll be right back. I'll do it the easy way. Ah! Saw that in a James Bond movie. Been wanting to do it ever since. Who raised their hand back here? Ah, yes. From where was she? From Meridian, Mississippi, are you not? Yes. Are you a country music fan is the question, since you're from Meridian.
Yes, I am. I'm from Meridian. I've lived there all of my life, and I am a country fan because of the Jimmy Rogers Memorial Festival that's held in Meridian. You're from Laurel? Good to see somebody really close to Meridian. Am I a racing fan? I guess I'm going to have to be, because I'm going to the Indianapolis 500 this year.
Whoa.
So. I don't know if I can make that.
Anybody else have a question you'd like to ask? Just raise your hand. I feel like I'm on the Donahue show here. Okay, whoa, whoa. I'm going to have to step in front of the big screen here for just a second. Whoa. Yes, what's your question?
Look like. Direct that question to my chaperone, Jeannie Akers, and she's standing right over there hiding behind the screen. Jeannie and I have had one laugh after the other. I think we've traveled from one end of the state to the other in one day, back up to this place, back up to that place. We get on the highway at 2 o'clock in the morning, and it's scared out of our minds, and we don't know where we're going, and we're heading in one direction, we're heading in another, and we just keep going. It's wonderful. I wish every young girl could see what the life of a Miss Mississippi is. I know it's exciting being Mrs. America and Miss America, but gosh, to see places in your own state that you've never seen before, you know, it's amazing that I've lived here all my life and I've not seen half the things that are here in the state.
Don't you ever get exhausted with the hectic schedule you keep up?
Very much, but it's excited energy that keeps you going. You know you have to be somewhere And when you get there, you're fine, but it's getting there and preparing yourself and, you know, taking those vitamin C's and getting some sleep on the road, but it's worth it. It's really worth it all.
Any other questions anybody has here?
Get with it. Use it like that. You got to put salt on this turkey. Get under her arms. Got it. Now, first of all, I washed this turkey, and then I dried it. Have that. And then I dried it real good, because when you put it in that hot grease, it's not good. Not good to put it right directly into it. Now, that's right. If you have a wet turkey, that grease gonna run out all over you, and that ain't good, too. Get on the arm there, baby. Hold it open. I ain't got it. Put a little in the cavity. Get on there. Add it in. Now, cayenne pepper. You know, put that in there. I appreciate them bringing me this cayenne pepper because I forgot to bring mine with me. It's just as good. Same thing. Ground cayenne pepper. I know everybody's saying, that's going to be hot. But it's not. It's going to be good. That's exactly right. Get on the arm. That's right. Put some here. Right here. Oh, man. Just a minute. Now, let me get him. Stand up there for me, baby. I want to put a little salt. Put a little salt down his craw. Little red pepper. Put her on her tummy. We're going to do the same thing back here. Going to rub it in as we put it on there. Oh, boy, that's going to be so good, I can't stand it myself. Now, little red pepper. Add it in. Get that leg out there where I can get it. Now you're going. And believe it or not, this is all the seasoning that this little old bird's going to need. Now, Janine, I got to wash my hands, baby. Open the dish towel around here. Tell you something, you put your hand up and scratch your eye and put that red pepper on there, you're going to cry for a week. I'm gonna take that mic from you, honey. I'm gonna go check how hot my grease is getting. Well, right now, I happen to make a couple of notes, some stories I want to tell you. And I'm gonna tell you one. A friend from Mississippi told me this story. He's Cajun just like me. He's half-bleed, I think, and I'm about half-bleed. I got a friend who was riding through the little town of Jeanneret, Louisiana, not too long ago. He was obeying the speed limit 25 miles an hour, and he looked in front of his automobile, and there was a chicken running right in front of him. That's what reminded me of the story of this turkey laying up here. That chicken was just running right in front of him 25 miles an hour. He said, look at that chicken. He looked at that chicken some more. He said, that chicken's got three legs. He said, I got to see this. So he picked up to run over the chicken. The chicken picked up too. He didn't want to be run over, no. 35 miles an hour. He said, the police gonna get me, but I got to see that chicken. And he picked up some more. The chicken picked up too. 55 miles an hour. That chicken just running along. He said, I'm gonna kill that chicken and see what he looked like. He picked up to 75 miles an hour. Chicken just running. All of a sudden, the chicken turned down the road. Didn't have to put on his brake. My friend passed it up, but he put on his brake there, back up in high gear reverse, go down a little dirt road. At the end of that road was a nice little house and a man and woman sitting on the front porch, rocking back and forth, back and forth. My friend got out and said, I hate the body, y'all, and please forgive me for this, but did either one of y'all see a three-legged chicken run by here, huh? The man says, oh, yeah, we raise them. My friend says, you raise the damn things? Is that right? Well, how come you raise three-legged chickens? He said, well, Man said, ain't nobody but me and my wife and my son, just three of us, and all three of us like the drumsticks, so we raised three-legged chicken. My friend says, what did they taste like? The man said, I don't know. We haven't been able to catch one of the damn things. We caught this old turkey. We're going to do something with it very shortly. What's it on, 325? Here we go. Hold still. I have these mittens that to keep from burning my hand. First, that's hot. Secondly, when I go to put that turkey in there, I don't want that grease popping up on my hand, no. Well, on 325, this is 5 gallons of peanut oil. Now you say, ooh, wee, wasting a lot of oil. No, you just keep that peanut oil and use it over and over. You can use it a long, long time. So never worry about wasting it because you're not. I knew that was gonna fall, didn't you? You got the camera on it? Girl, whatever you are. Here we go. Is the camera on this? Now y'all look on the big screen so you can see what I'm doing. And watch how carefully I do it. You see I dried that turkey properly? Go ahead on there, baby. See how come I put it in there slow, slow? That's why I put it in there slow, slow. But I needed that big fork, baby. I take this fork and straighten that little rascal around the way it all is submerged. You see that? Don't that pretty? Now give that turkey a hand, will you?
Right. Well, she's going to make some of our...
Don't you miss the same one because you want the
They say if you come out of all but one thing, that'll be a pass.
Thank you. introduce a fella named Howard Rosenstein, who is with Soaps Alive, who will introduce the stars of Another World. Let's give Howard a good round of applause. Stars. Number one, I just want you to give a nice big round of applause to everybody here with the food show who invited Soaps Alive out here today, so please give them a round of applause. Great. Number two, I want you to give yourselves a round of applause for being so patient and being such a good audience. Yes! Come on! All right, listen, I have one thing to say. I want some screams from this audience. I want to hear some screamers. So come on, let me hear some screams from people. All right. This girl was a good screamer, so she gets a picture right over here. So I want to hear some more screams when everybody comes out. Okay, before I bring them out, there are a couple of things that I just want to go over. How many of you have ever seen a Soaps Alive show before? Right? Okay, good. For those of you who haven't, let me tell you a little bit about us. Soaps Alive has been what we like to think of as fulfilling your favorite fantasies for the past 10 years. What we do is we bring your favorite stars, we take them out of that small television set that's in your living room, in your kitchen, in your bedroom, in your bathroom, wherever. We take your favorite stars, your love gods, your love goddesses, those sex symbols. We take them from that small screen and we bring them to you, to your community, so you can see what they're like, see how similar they are to their characters they portray on television, and see how different they are. How many of you like all of the people who are coming here today? Well, I have a big surprise for you, because all of you are going to change your mind. You are all going to love them when they come out. They're just as wonderful in person as they are on the screen, really. So this is what we're going to be doing. I'm going to be walking around getting questions from all of you. How many of you have thought of some questions? Yeah? Like, what are some of the questions you want to hear? What? Like what? What? Is Marley... what they wear underneath those bed sheets in the love scenes. Yeah! All right, what about this? What about, has Tom Eplin ever had to kiss anyone with bad breath? Yeah, come on, we want to hear some good, interesting questions. So I'm going to be coming around. I'm going to be running through the audience, so raise your hand and come over to me, and I'll be getting some questions from you. A couple of different rules that we have here with Soaps Alive. Number one, please don't ask for you to have your autographs taken. Get their autograph, because with this huge crowd that we have here today, if we do it for one person, then we're going to have to do it for everybody, and there just isn't enough time. Number two, please don't ask to have your pictures taken with them also, for the exact same reason, unfortunately. I mean, it's fortunate that we have such a big crowd here today, but there will be two lucky young women who will be able to come up here and share a little Marley Victoria kiss with Mr. Jake. To present to you Mr. Tom Eplin, Pamela Kay, and Ellen Wheeler of Another World. Let's hear the scream! Come on!
How are you guys?
Oh, you're quiet. Try that again, Tom.
Let's hear some screams. Who's excited? Come on! Listen, wait. 1 second. Before we get started, I have one question to ask this whole audience here.
It's wonderful.
It's wonderful.
Ellen,
morning just for this, right?
Yeah. Yes, we did.
And how was your flight? Everybody treated you nicely?
Mm-hmm.
We got to fly first class.
Ellen spilled 7-Up in my seat.
I know. You spilled it in your own seat. It was just sitting there, and he sat on top of it, actually.
All right.
His own fault. His own fault.
Hmm. Well, listen, we have a couple of nice questions from the audience. Hey, Tom, let's flash this side. Let's be a little bit balanced.
In the blue right there on the end?
You see a question?
This is audience participation. When everyone else laughs, you laugh too. There you go. I think I wasn't watching over there.
Listen, we've got a question over here, okay?
Tom, are you married?
No, but I'm looking. We're
going to
start a single file line right here during the day.
Who wants to get married to Tom? Raise your hand. Are you all married?
I'm not yet. I'm looking. Harder and harder every day.
Pam, what about you? Are you married?
I'm so lonely, especially with these guys. I feel so lonely.
Aww.
And I'm definitely looking.
I do wear an engagement ring. So I do wear an engagement ring.
You do?
And whose engagement ring is it, Ellen?
Who gave that engagement?
Where did you find the engagement ring? No, wait, we got a story. Where did you find the engagement ring, Ellen?
How long ago? It was about 4 months ago. I went over to Tom's house. We were rehearsing. I don't know if it was
Marley. Sure.
Yeah.
We were rehearsing.
I don't know if it was Marley and Victoria or what, but just there, like, sitting on his table amongst all these papers was this diamond ring. I said,
the last I ever saw of the diamond ring.
He said, it's my now.
Yeah! Listen, we've got a question back here.
Did you guys have as much fun in Arizona as it looked like on the TV?
Go ahead, TJ.
Well, did you?
I was sick. If you go to Arizona, don't drink the water. I didn't have a good time in Arizona. It was a beautiful place to be, but I spent all the off time.
Off.
Did you guys see Thursday? Did anyone see the helicopter jump?
Yeah!
I want to tell you something. I'll bet you nobody believes this. I jumped. That was really me. That was not a stunt, man. That I really
jumped. Yeah!
So there.
Listen, we've got a question for you over here, Ellen.
Which one fits your personality most, Marley or Victoria?
Well,
can't Pamela answer that one?
Wait. Hold it. I think it depends on who you ask.
Well, let's ask Pamela. Pamela, what do you think?
Pam used to be my roommate, so she can probably answer that.
We used to be roommates, right. So I saw both sides of her. I saw the Marley side and I saw the Victoria side.
I think when you meet me, I probably not like this because, you know, I'm like buzzing because I get nervous in front of all of you. But when you first meet me, just normally, I think I seem more like Marley, but I'm probably more like Victoria. Oh, dear.
Pamela, wait, let's hear this. Pamela, you shared a dressing room with her? Or you were roommates?
We were roommates.
You were roommates?
Yeah.
Is she neat?
You be careful how you answer this, Miss K.
Is she neat? She's a good cook. She's a very good cook.
Moving right along. Here, we've got a question over here. This is also for you, Ellen.
How do you change to Victoria?
She looks like her sister. I know. I was going to say, God, you look like you could have been me when I was a little girl. It's very odd to look at you.
Like Danielle.
Yeah. They do all of the Marley scenes in the morning, or else they do all the Victoria scenes in the morning, and then they give me about 15 minutes to a half an hour to change. So then I run back upstairs to the dressing room, and the makeup people and the hair people and everybody just work all at once, and we change me into the other person. Then I come down and I do all the other scenes after a while.
Amazing.
Here, I've got a question over here. This is for you, Tom.
Yes, I do.
Can I just touch you?
Now remember, just a touch. Yeah, we're giving away kisses later.
Yeah.
How did you feel about that?
Oh.
Here, we've got a question.
That's my sister.
Thanks, sis. Here's a question.
Yes, I have souvenirs for all of you.
Oh,
may I send them to you, please?
Sure.
Go right up.
Oh, that's so
thank
sweet.
You
just
very
go, to,
much.
Go right to the
thank
edge of the
you.
Stage. How nice. Who else has gifts? Who else has money? Throw it. No, I'm only kidding. No. Listen, you know, somebody was asking me before, they wanted to know if you have any free time. What do you do in your free time?
That's a good question. Ellen and myself lately have been working on a film.
What's the name of it?
Mr. Lunch.
Mr.
Yeah, it's
Mr.
a four man. Thank you very much.
I'm a sweet thing.
A large.
All right.
This morning,
on the flight here,
Pam was working on her screenplay that she's writing. So we all do business-oriented things on our time off as well.
Pam, what kind of screenplay are you writing?
It's a murder mystery.
Really?
Yes.
Are you writing a part in there for yourself?
No, actually, I'm not. No, I'm not at all.
But for me.
And me.
Oh.
Really?
No.
Yes, you just found that part out.
Oh, okay. That's what I do in my off time. I plan murders. No.
Okay, let's go on to the next topic.
Is Donna as snobby in person as she is on TV?
Who likes Donna here? How many of you like Donna Love? How many of you hate Donna Love? Well, let's hear the dirt.
Go ahead, Pam.
She's your mother.
There's nobody
she's
sweeter.
Wonderful. She's really wonderful.
I don't know, Tom. You've kissed her more than the rest of us.
What? I did what?
Kissed her. I said kiss.
Kissed
Donna?
I said Anna. Anna. You've kissed Anna more than the rest of us.
She's a nice lady.
Yeah, nice.
Well, let me ask you something. Is there anybody on the show who you don't like?
Conversations with them or anything.
Yeah, for the last 6 months that you've seen us together, that's all we, just about basically, myself and her, that's all that's worked together, me and Ellen, a lot.
And
she works with Russell, who plays Carter.
Carter, yeah, and
whoever,
D.
And D.
And D, right.
So you only cross with a few certain people, actually.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
And, you know, I think I've met Victoria Windham really more than like 10 times. I've been there a year and a half.
She plays
Rachel. Right.
How many of you like Rachel, huh?
We'll tell her.
Well, what about, is there anybody, besides the three of you, obviously, the three of you are very friendly, but do you hang around with other people from the show?
Not a whole lot. Yeah, that was an odd question you asked before about time off, because it's double-edged. When we're working a lot, when you see us work for one day, that means we put in one day of work. The show done in one day is taped in one day. So if we're on 5 days that week, more often than not, we didn't do anything that week but the show. It's only in the days when you see us two or three times in a week where we have any free time at all. So there's not a whole lot of time when you're working on a regular basis to hang out.
Right, because our days go from about 6 in the morning, an average is from 6 in the morning till 6 in the evening. It's not uncommon to work from 6 in the morning till 10 in the evening. So it doesn't leave really a lot of time. There's commuting after that, before and after that, too. So that doesn't leave a lot of time for you to, you know, go hang out with people if you want to get any sleep and learn your lines for the next day.
Did you, when all of you started on the show, did you have any trouble memorizing all the lines?
All the time.
We still have trouble memorizing all the lines.
Well, somebody was asking before, I couldn't get to them, but they wanted to know, do you ad-lib any of your own lines?
I write them down everywhere. That's true.
Oh, hysterical.
This is true. There's a scene coming up.
Little papers everywhere along the set.
There's a scene coming up.
the red sand about every 4 or 5 feet. My little lines. I have great eyesight. And I'll hide them in the sand, and I kind of cover the edges, and you can't see that it's red. So I just walk along like this. You know, Marley, there's one thing I want to tell you. And that is that I'm crazy about you. I've asked her if she'll let me tape them on her, you know, but she never would do that. Do you have trouble memorizing your lines, Pam?
No.
All I do is say,
oh, it's my baby, it's my baby.
These two people have that memory where they don't even read the script, and they come in the morning, and they open the script up for the first time. This is the truth. They're going to do this in an hour, right? And the first time, they open it at 7:30, and they go, okay, I'm going to say this. If I'm going to tape it on Friday, I have to start on Monday to memorize what I'm going to do on Friday. Then I even have to cheat with them on the floor.
He has to have his papers on the floor because he works with me and he never knows what I'm going to say. Because I look at mine at 7:30 in the morning, so I'm just making it up as I go. He has to keep me in line.
Okay. Here we go. Moving right along.
We met Larry the other day and he said that you can sing. Will you please sing us a song?
You sing?
Happy birthday. Where'd you hear that at? Did you really hear that? Raise your hand who just said that.
Where's that girl?
And you heard that I sang?
Who heard that he sang? How many of you were here?
Okay, that was a joke. He doesn't sing, but he dances like all get out. Okay.
Who wants to see him dance?
He doesn't sing, he doesn't dance. Next question, please.
Moving right along over here.
You've already answered that. And when is Blaine and Sandy coming back on the show?
How many of you want Blaine and Sandy to come back on the show? You miss them? Okay.
Can I ask you a question? Can I ask everybody out there a question? Is everybody participating?
Is everybody going to
participate? Raise your hand if you're going to participate in my next question. You there in the second row. There you go. Thank you, sir. How many miss Perry?
Yeah!
Perry's gone, you miss Perry. Now, with your hands, show me how many people wrote a letter in and said, bring Perry back. You wrote a letter in and said, bring Perry back. One person and there's 1,000. You guys killed Perry.
Shame on you.
How can we stand up here with people who killed Perry? Your audience response is what keeps us on the show.
Yeah.
Jake was supposed to be on the show for 3 months.
Victoria was supposed to be there for one. One month.
Right. When you guys write in, what you say to NBC is what stays. So if you have something to say, go ahead.
They consider that 1,000 people agree with each letter that comes in. So if all of you wrote one letter, that would be 100,000 people to them. That's a large majority for them.
For everybody here who doesn't know the address, can you just give the address? Or
get your pens and pencils.
Pens and papers out. Pens and papers. Everybody, if you're not really going to get one, just act like you're going to do it. There you go.
Busyness. We like that.
In fact, ask another question, and I'll come back to the address. I'll give everybody time to get their pens and papers out.
Okay, here we are. Hi. We've got a question right over here. This is for you, Tom.
Tom, what do you wear when you're doing love scenes in bed?
De Lorena. That's it.
And cowboy boots.
Jake doesn't do anything without his boots.
What about you, Ellen? What do you wear?
They're all doubles. She never does them herself.
We have these little half slips that we wear. It depends on what you see.
And what about you, Pam?
I wear a slip. I'm the worst. I am the worst. I make everybody leave.
Okay.
But she joined his nudist colony, too, so.
Just kidding. You know what? I just have to interrupt the show just for 1 second. There's a lost child by the name of Brad Matthews wearing a striped dark blue shirt, blondish hair, blue jeans and tennis shoes. If anybody here finds him, can you bring him to the stage or contact one of the staff? He's 3 years old.
Brad Matthews.
Brad, if anybody sees him.
Okay, we're not talking until Brad comes back.
Okay, here, we've got a question right over here.
Yes, Ellen, I'd like to ask you, if you and the young woman who played Nancy were already adept at horseback riding when you were riding in the desert, or did you have to take lessons, or how did you handle that?
I want to ask you that myself. You guys were really good.
Both of us have ridden. I had ridden a lot when I was young. I think Jane had too, but she had ridden English, which is really quite different from Western. So, although it was a lot of fun, it was a lot of riding. We did a lot more riding than you ever actually saw. So, it was fun, but I had the worst bruises that I've ever had in my entire life. And they weren't in a place where I could show anybody, so I can't prove how bad they were. But they were bad.
But I'll point to them. They were right there.
Here we have a question way back here.
Marley, you remember when they first started talking about you coming onto the show, and they were talking about you were supposed to be engaged to somebody, and Donna broke up the engagement and all that, and then when you came on, you were real young. What happened?
Okay, honestly, they were supposed to cast the Marley character, and they couldn't find anybody that they liked, so finally they had to settle for me. That's kind of what happened. It took them about 3 or 4 months to find somebody. So I don't know. I never watched the show before I came on. I never saw it, so I don't know what happened before that. Was she engaged? Was she engaged? God, 3 boyfriends. See, I thought she'd only had 2.
She only has 1.
She only has 1. Had 2. Sorry. You can beat me up later.
Behind these balloons over here, we have a question.
The balloon question for the day.
Would you come to act like Victoria?
How many want to see Ellen act like Victoria?
You should have seen her this morning when she got up in the car. She reminded you just like Victoria.
Oh, God, I don't know. I don't know what to say or do.
Say no.
No. No, I will. In a little while, as a matter of fact. I'm going to do some stuff with Tom, and you'll get to see Victoria. All right? Is that a deal? Okay.
Here, this is the question over here.
I've got a catching up to do. Is Marley and Jake still together or what?
Or what? Is probably.
I haven't watched the show in a while because I'm in school, you know?
What was the last thing we saw? Jake and Marley joined the Hells Angels in... Oh, we got fixed up back to basically. They're together.
They're together.
In a tent? We won't talk about the
tent. Okay, since then, they broke up. They got back together. They broke up, and now they're back together.
Here, we've got a question.
She's just like hanging out.
Okay, we've got a question over here.
I want to know what happened to Nicole Love.
What happened to Nicole Love? How many of you miss Nicole Love? Whatever happened to that girl?
We work on contracts on the show. And when your contract is up, they have the option to say so long to you. So again, what Tom
said... Or you have the option.
Yeah, or you have the option to go. And again, what Tom said applies. If there's not enough audience response, then they're not going to ask you to stay.
Which brings us to the next part of this thing.
Yes.
The address that you two are waiting for, since you're the only 2, 3, and a picture. How'd you get a picture?
Yeah.
She's a screamer. Wait, can we hear the scream one more time? Very good.
I'll get somebody, don't worry.
Later. The address, by the way, is... Whoever you're writing to's name. You can write the character name or you can write their name.
So Pam K.
Pam K. Another care of another world. Tell me when I can go on.
Boy, this is full of suspense, isn't it?
30 Rockefeller Plaza. New York, New York.
10020. You know what? I have a feeling if you write the character's name or the actor's name, care of Another World, NBC, or whatever the affiliate is,
right.
New York, New York, if you're at NBC, then it'll also get there, too.
Right.
If you forget the 30 Rockefeller Plaza.
You know, it's gotten there. This also brings up a good point. Be patient when you write to us. Okay, because it takes about a month for the letters to get completely to us.
Oh, even longer.
Or even longer.
Up to 3 months.
Yeah.
But all three of us return all the
letters. We all write back.
Get pictures,
it just takes
8 by 10 beautiful pictures. Well, maybe not beautiful, but pictures, nonetheless.
What are some of the things that people write to you about, Pam? Do you get a lot of fan mail?
I did. I get great fan mail. I got booties for the baby.
Oh.
I got graduation cards. I got wonderful, wonderful things.
Really? And you all write back, and you all answer all your own mail?
Every letter.
So yeah. Write those letters! Yeah!
Yeah!
Who's
going
to write letters?
Who's going to write a letter?
Letters from everyone.
That's right. What about, do you have any fan clubs? Is there a fan club for the three of you at all?
There's the Another World Viewer Alliance, which is in Pittsburgh.
And I do have a fan club.
We both.
How many members?
Yeah, we both have fan clubs that you can write in through the same address.
Yeah, my fan club is at the same address.
Great. Okay, here we have a good question over here.
A good question right here.
This one's for Arlene. I want to know if he can kiss good.
Is Tom a good kisser? Let's see if why don't you say?
Now, if I give away all the secrets of how good a kisser he is, then I'll never get another one. He'd be so crowded and so busy all the time, just standing and giving, yes.
Yeah, did you guys
Tom
read
is the best kisser.
Did anybody read Soap Opera Digest this time? Did you guys read that in Soap Opera Digest? Okay, fine. Maybe there's a different Soap Opera Digest than I had. There's a thing about kissing in there.
Tom has an article this month in Soap Opera Digest. If you want to find out all about Tom's personal life, buy Soap Opera Digest.
Well, listen, Ellen. On a scale of 1 to 10, how would you rate Tom as a kisser?
14 and a half.
Really?
Wait, it works the other way. Tom, what about you? How would you rate Ellen?
Be careful how you answer. If you'd like to eat for the next month.
Every time I kiss her, I pass out. I don't even remember.
Now, see, that's a safe answer. You can decide that that's because I'm such a good kisser or because I'm the worst kisser in the world, and he doesn't want to have to think
Honey,
about it.
Honey, you're a very good do a Marley and Victoria kiss.
You want to do the
Marley and Victoria kiss? You guys want to see a Marley and Victoria kiss?
Yeah. All right. Where's that little girl who's over here? Wait, there's some woman brought up the... There she is. Come on over here, the balloon girl. We have somebody... Let's do the Marley kiss.
Okay.
Okay.
Oh.
Okay. This is Marley.
First, we're going to use this Marley, and
this
then I'll
Marley.
Use Marley. Come on up here.
This is Marley.
Taylor, you're gonna be Marley for a couple minutes. Hold on.
Give him room.
I get to
How's
be
this
the
look?
Film
Did you guys
man.
See this on the soap?
How are you?
Hi.
So I have our Victoria kisser.
We better back up, Pam. I have a feeling we could be in the way.
It's hot up here.
You get to have this yourself. Don't shake, it's okay.
I gotta tell you something. Ellen's really my girlfriend. She's gonna get really mad at this one. This is coaching from the sideline. I don't like this. Watch the show, huh?
is
Carter.
Okay, is his father? Okay, as you notice, I do have an address on the back of my phone. There on the right. And also a comment on your little boy, the baby boy. He's cute, but I think he's a little bit dark.
You think he's too dark for me?
Yeah.
Oh.
No, he's gonna get lighter as he grows up.
Yeah, no. Yeah. And smaller, and smaller. He was premature, really.
Here we have one final question over here.
Tom, I noticed you were the most recent on the show. Who'd you talk to get the job? I mean, like, I'm into acting and I didn't call the job. And, I mean, how did you get the job?
How did we get a job on the show?
How did all of you get the job on the show?
Probably three different ways. Pam, let's start. We'll just come on down and we'll tell you how each of us got our jobs.
How did you start?
I was living in Los Angeles, quietly living in West Hollywood, acting, doing commercials.
For sure.
Near the Galleria, as a ballet girl and all that stuff. Anyway, I got an audition, and then I got a call back, and then I got another call back, and then I got a test, which is when they put you on video and they sent it to New York, and then I got another test. And that was Friday at noon. Monday at noon, they called me and said, you have to be in New York to work on Thursday. So I was calling my friends going, oh, guess what? I don't live next door to you anymore. I'm going to New York. Oh, great. How long are you going to be gone? 2 years. So it happens real fast for me.
Mixed. Okay, go ahead. Ellen, how did you get your start?
Basically, as far as getting this job, it's the same. We all ended up getting an audition. How everybody starts in the business is really different. Some people go to acting school. Some people just start acting in their community theaters. Some people just literally do get discovered on the streets. There's a zillion different ways. I would say if it's what you want to do, just find the avenue that works best for you. If that's going to school or being in all the plays that you can get in, and keep doing it. It's going to take a long time. It's not going to happen next week.
Yeah.
I started when I was 3, and I didn't do anything for a lot of years that made me real money. So it's going to take, it can take a long time. That's the most important thing, is to stick to whatever road you choose to get there. You have to stick to that.
What's that?
She's going to die if she doesn't touch him.
Okay. Oh, is she gonna die if she doesn't touch him?
We all are, though, she says.
What is she whispering to you?
She has pretty eyes.
All right.
She has pretty eyes.
Yeah. Well, listen, did you tell her? I was paying attention before. Did you tell how you got your start?
Did I tell how I got my start?
Yeah.
So it gets boring. That gets boring. How we got here is more exciting. I tested, they flew me out, and they wrote the role of Jake. That was it. I mean, I tested for another role in the show. I tested for a role of Ben. Remember Ben?
Yeah.
I tested. He's cute? I'll tell him you said so. Am I as cute from the front as I am from the back? I don't know. You guys tell me.
No.
But at any rate, I tested for the role. I did last night. To go to sleep. This is a family show. Come on now. Anyway, I tested for the role of Ben, and they said he's too old to play Ben, and they wrote the role of Jake. And that was that.
All right, and aren't you glad all three of them are on the show? You'll be able to pick up some pictures of Pam, Ellen, and Tom. But we will be back at 3:30. Please, thank you for being so...
Just, can we just get here?
What?
No, there's...
We can't...
shell top, matching sweater jacket, and striped pink and cream skirt with elasticized waist. A warm design for the cold winter days ahead. You are a luscious pink lamb's wool and angora jacquard chemise, a v-neck vest with chemise highlights, soft rib skirt, and satin jacquard bow blouse. Waist-length double-breasted jacket, side-angled pockets, and a wide double lapel in wool. To accompany the jacket, we chose matching satin jacquard bow blouse and tailored slacks. Our Chouse line is located in our new directions department. Skirt. Not only a good investment for the holidays, but for spring as well. These bright colors will be very popular for the spring fashion season. An antique wool, white linen, and cotton imported blouse, exquisitely detailed plaits and rose appliques, a round neckline and sleeves, and to match a soft didwool skirt. Christian Ajar creates such softness for the woman who enjoys wearing slacks. And fully lined designer wool slacks. This group is also available to you in winter white. Fashion She Simply Must Have by Christian Ajar, a boxy blazer fully lined in elegant winter wool white. Matching skirt and blouse, a total outfit of winter white brings such a subtle of elegance to any woman who chooses to wear it. College Town says because you don't stop being a junior when you become a woman. For the working woman, they designed a waist-style fitted jacket, bow neck tie blouse, and straight line skirt with pleating on each side for easy movement. College Town is located in our junior department. There'll be many festivities ahead, parties and dinners, and you'll need all the essentials to make a dazzling appearance this holiday season. Elegance of taffeta? Well, it's back for the holidays. By Santa Cruz, a Victorian lavender blouse, stand-up puff long sleeves, and a tiny rib pleated front and matching skirt, fitted at waistline and extended to fullness. To accent, we add a Rocco Romance belt of pastel stones, pearls, crystal, and golden filigree, and matching earrings, a collection by Rhea. Shirt with deep sleeves and side sleeves. The pants who's looking for style and comfort, a very sophisticated and slenderizing party pant combination by Liz Claiborne. The fuchsia black print top with the wide padded shoulders and drops to the hip line with a side tie sash, and to complete, silky black party pants. Pink chemise, the ever-popular jumpsuit by Liz Claiborne, features front and closed pockets, shoulder tabs, and an open waistline, which we belted in. Very comfortable and eye-catching by Liz Claiborne. Sequin top and genie party pants by Liz Claiborne. Don't forget to add a black sequin evening bag by Madrid. The sequin top is also available in an alternate color of hot pink. Santa Cruz, a fun party statement from our junior department, can be worn with an off-white crepe-length, waist-length pleated front blouse, all by Santa Cruz for juniors. For a special evening out or a romantic dinner, a China blue blouse by Alexandria with stitched front pleats and double-breasted buttons, accompanied by a black satin skirt with side enclosure by Breckenridge. To enhance the look, a hand-beaded and sequin belt. Liz Claiborne's long silk tunic blouse and narrow leg pants. We chose to belt it in with a hand-beaded belt and add a matching beaded evening bag. Make a grand entrance in this group from Santa Cruz. Full taffeta pink skirt and matching blouse is overlaid with a hand-woven shell sweater with woven satin lavender ribbon weaved throughout. Twas the night before Christmas, when all through the house not a creature was stirring, but as morning arose, they put on their robes and comfortable clothes to see what Santa had chose. A crushy, buoyant robe with satin and lace yoke inset and ruffled collar and satin and lace accents along the cuff. A lovely way to appear on an early Christmas morning. Wrapped collar, it ties at the waist, and features satin leaflet appliques to tee top with red stirrup pants by Heartland, a fun, demental design in cotton fleece. Morning, how about a cute reindeer shirt and stretch pants from BJ Designs, a popular item this Christmas in our junior department. The shirts are available in white and red with various Christmas designs and matching pants to coordinate. Jeans is grouped with a brush red acrylic sweater with accents of stars and moon symbols in a bright yellow and green. Underneath, we added a yellow cotton shirt, all by Genesis, in our junior department. Department. There's always room in every woman's wardrobe for dresses. We'd like to show a selection you might like to find under your Christmas tree.
Right.
gives you grace and style in your wardrobe. The look is polished and classic. Trim. The blouse bodice has a dropped waist and a separate pleated skirt by In the Mood. Dresses such as this one, a wide padded shoulders and wrap style front narrows to a less sized waistline with matching tie sash, and the color adds such richness and appeal. Which can be carried as a clutch or shoulder bag. Romance in red velvet, very appropriate for a Christmas dinner. Scoop neckline, long sleeves, and fitted waist with a ribbon sash tie and accented with rhinestone buttons, a holiday move set by designer Liz Claiborne. And white statement, sailor style collar in white with a black piping, Lusant style waistline, fitted hips area into a soft pleat, a classic style by J.H. Paul found in our Regency department. This holiday season, and invite each of you to visit our store at the Metro Center, where we're ready to make your Christmas a joy to shop for. Thank you so much.
We've just got a lot of beautiful girls with us today. Thanks.
How about Ole Miss? Doesn't that sound great?
With you. It's such an honor to be out here with you today. I have about three songs for you today, and the first one is called New York, New York, and the second one is My Kind of Guy, and the third one is one I'm sure you're all going to love. It's called God Bless the USA. Start spreading the news.
Step around the beach, it all Why he's running.
to me. And I heard some of you out there, and I know that some of you know it, so if you want to sing along, just feel free. God bless the USA.
Wait till you see this. All the kids for this event will have to kind of stand back from the stage because we got a lot of dancing going on. At this time, we'd like to introduce the Country Western Spotlights In-Step Studio from Jackson, Capital City Chasers from Jackson, and the Fitness Zone from Brandon, Mississippi. Are you ready, Dot? Okay, let's give them a big hand. You're going to see some fancy footwork here today.
better.
Some fancy footwork there.
Okay, who's gonna be next on this one? Come on, inquiring minds want to know here.
Don't let her lie.
We got the lie detector hooked up to the microphone. If you say a falsehood, the alarm goes off.
Well, that is a part of a young woman's upbringing, is to date men and, you know, have a social life and things like that. And I'm no exception, certainly not. But as far as a boyfriend or a future marriage or anything like that is in store, I'm concentrating on just having the best year that I can. And I'm 20 today, and I have a lot ahead of me. But I do like to date when I have time. And, you know, there's special young men that I like to go out with. And if Susan tells you any different, don't believe her.
Meet me right after this, right in the corner. I'll tell you all about her, really. Now, last year during my school year, I dated a football player for Ole Miss. And then I dated someone else this summer, and now I'm not dating anyone. They both left me. No, it wasn't like that. The role of Miss America is for someone that does not get air sick, homesick, or love sick. And I don't really have time for a boyfriend. We understood after I won that I couldn't really see them. Now, when I'm home, I can date if I want to. If there's someone in my hometown that I want to go out with that asks me out when I'm home, it's fine. I can go out with them. But I have no particular so-called boyfriend right now, so if there's any applications, no, I'm just kidding.
That wasn't the lie detector alarm going on.
How is it? No, I don't have a boyfriend.
Applications will be taken after the show. Please bring resume and photograph. Oh, speaking of questions, I have a very important question while I wander over here. I mean, the heck with world affairs. Does anybody have an update on the ECMO? I suppose we could ask this of each person, if you'd like. We'll make this an optional question for extra points. What are your plans after your reign? What are you going to do?
I don't really know. I have one more year at the University of Mississippi. And, yes, that's where I go. I go to Ole Miss. I had to drop out this year because I'm on the road the whole year. I don't know what I'm going to do.
going to do. I'm going to take, first of all, a month or two off. Take my shoes. I'm not going to wear another pair of shoes for 2 months after it's over with, I don't think. You know, no makeup, no rollers. I'm going to take a little bit of time off just to rest. But after that, I've been thinking seriously about moving out to California and trying to go into acting. But I don't really know right now. I'm going to wait and see if there's any opportunities for me or things there waiting for me, if there's any.
There we go. Stir around. Get a little juice in there. More juice. Stir them garlic. I don't want to forget anything, Janine. That's looking good. That is looking good. I don't know if we got enough room for it. Let me see how much this weighs. Half of it. Cut half that up. That's right. This right here will be fine. Got to get you on here. This is what takes longest to cook. Onion. Bell pepper. Get that going like that. Get that B.I.G. whole sausage in there. Oh, that'll be fine. That'll be enough. That'll be enough, baby. I don't think I have enough room. Lacking 1 ounce of putting 2 cups in here, so I'll add an extra ounce of wine. Yeah. Pour it in there for me, will you?
When?
Oh. I didn't throw that on the floor. We need a little more wine, Janine. I said an extra ounce of wine. That'll do it. Now, we got to put a little seasoning in this. Come on, spread around there. Get red all over. Now, jambalaya, this is a red jambalaya. We make jambalaya with chicken, and we brown the chicken off, or we make it with the fresh pork, and we brown it all. We just make a brown jambalaya. But we're not going to brown this. We're not going to brown this sausage off. We don't want it to look like it's pale. We put that tomato sauce in there, make a red jambalaya, and the reason we use the wine is because the bell peppers are bitter, and tomato sauce is bitter, and you put the wine, you take the bitter out. And that's why we use that. People wonder why I use wine. That's one of the reasons. It ain't the big reason, but that's one of the reasons. All right. I'll put a little Louisiana hot sauce in it. Now, I said Louisiana hot sauce, made from cayenne peppers. I think this calls for about a tablespoon full. He said, I'm on a measure. I'm on a measure. A tablespoon. Don't even know whose table you're talking about, you know. Now, that's a tablespoon full. That's enough. Now. Oh, that's cooking good, yeah. Shake your sauce and you leave it around your Worcestershire sauce. 2 tablespoons full of Worcestershire sauce. I think that's what this recipe calls for. Gonna do it this afternoon anyhow. That's 1 tablespoon. You know that I didn't pull that plum up? 2. Didn't pull it plum up. Either time. You salt it to taste. Remember, your sausage has salt. Your sausage got salt on your sausage. You're going to taste it first, see how salty it is. But you got to have salt for your rice and your vegetable. I got 3 cups of rice. You got a spoon, measure? I'm gonna put 3 teaspoons full of salt in here for the 3 cups of rice. That's what I'm gonna do. You can bet your last nickel that that's a teaspoon full. I don't have a measure with me. You got one? You're gonna get a measure. I'm gonna prove to you I know what I'm talking about. My hand's clean. Stir. Looking good all the time. I guarantee. You know, I was going down Peace Highway. It runs through Prince 7 where I live, and the engineer laid Peace Highway out, the same one laid out part of Jackson. He was drunk about 8 weeks before he drew the first line. You get behind an automobile on Peace Highway, you stay there. There ain't no way to get around it. Now, I'd gone down Peace Highway, and I got behind an automobile, and there were a boy and a girl in that car going down Peace Highway, sitting up close to each other like a sick kid to a heartbreak. But they both hard of hearing. That old boy driving that car down that road half doing 2 jobs. And all of a sudden, romp, 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 and she whispered to him, say, honey, I hate to tell you this, but I believe we got a flat tire. He said, what you said? She said, I believe we got a flat tire. Better stop and look on that. He said, okay. So he stopped the car, he get out there and look on that. They got a flat tire. Well, they get out there and they change the tire, get back in that car, and start off some more, romp, romp, romp. That damn fool done changed the wrong tire. One teaspoon full in there right now. Here's the second teaspoon full. Y'all don't think I know what I'm talking about. But I do. You see there? 2 teaspoons. 3 teaspoons. That's all I'm going to put in there.
You done with these?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. She borrowed that from somebody. I don't carry them with me. You got to stir this right, you know. Now, I'm going to put the sausage in here and hope I got enough room for that rice. Well, there's a lot of sausage. I got 3 cups of rice got to go in here somewhere. Show you what I'm talking about. You cook this until most of the fluid is gone out. Not just water, the rice and the I got to put a little more water in that because it's not enough. And we put cold water on it. I'll put about a couple of cups. You got in there. That's what's going to happen. There you go. Now that's enough. I'm going to cook this now. I'm going to let it boil. Well, I try to think of another story to tell you. I tell you, tell you a true story. It happened not long ago down where I live. There's a lady. Went over to a little plant there near where I live and applied for a job. She walked in there, and the personnel people were sitting there. This lady was sitting at the desk. And she said, sit yourself down. The little old lady sat down. She said, all right, we got to pull out this application. What's your name? She told her. What your husband's name? The same as mine. She said, I know what his front name is. She told her. How many children you got? She told him. Where you live? She told him. How long you been living there? She told him. What's your birthday? She said, April the 12th. First now people say, what year? She said, every damn year, you fool.
Chablis is what
I use, Chablis. They don't make sore turn anymore, but it's a dry white wine. You want to put it as quick as you can. You put it in and take the bitterness out of the bell pepper and the tomato sauce, which it does. Okay, you got all that now. Am I going too fast, baby? Oh, shut. Now, I got that in there. And I look and let it stir around a little bit, and I figure, well, all my vegetables are getting more done all the time. Then I put 2 pounds of smoked sausage, cut up in bite pieces, about a 3/4 inch thick. Louisiana smoked sausage, of course. Justin Wilson bread, the best, it's the best, it's the best. Got that Cajun flavor on it, man, I tell you right now. But I'll tell you what I usually do. I usually put my, about a tablespoonful of hot sauce in there first, before putting the sausage, and 2 tablespoonfuls of lean pan Worcestershire sauce, and that's what I use. Now, you can use any kind of Worcestershire you want to, but always use a Louisiana salt, hot sauce made from cayenne pepper. Not from any other kind, like a jalapeno or Tabasco, because they're too hot. Okay. Jesse Thompson, Mama is lost. Jesse's 6 years old up here. Mama, come on up here and let Jesse know that you ain't lost no more. She's up here at the stage. Come on. All right. Now, I stopped and didn't put the sausage in, you notice? Get all my liquids in there. Put your salt in there. For every cup of rice, put a teaspoon full of salt.
This recipe is in one of my cookbooks. Oh, boy,
good year. You see it up there, Cameron? Y'all see it all right up here? Go ahead, cook there. I'm going to fix something else over here very shortly. If I remember everything goes in it, you need what you do in my clipboard.
Right, boy. Whew. I'll tell you
one thing that smells so good it makes you kind of weak. Boy, now, I grew up working in the dairy. Take care, man. That Larry Valentine with Mississippi Valley Gas, let's give him a hand. Here let's go. You know, I could let this cook a little bit more, but I got other things I got to do. I'm in no hurry, though. I ain't no big hurry. I just, by golly, watch it cook and think about it. And think of a old story I want to tell you. It's all right, it ain't quite ready yet, Janine. Years ago, I got a friend that's rich. He got oil well and pump all night and make my money and spend the next day, and that rich. But us kids can think money's something to spend just before you get it. So that's the way I live. He went down to New Orleans and went to a big hotel down the French Quarter. He don't get a room, though. He gets a whole doggone suit, about 4 3 rooms. He get up there and he call a bellman boy named Paul LaGrange. Y'all call him Paul LaGrange, not knowing no better. He said, Paul? Paul said, yes, sir. He said, I want you to get me a female woman. Paul said, you got the right man. What you want, a blonde, a brunette, a red hair, or a châtain? Now, châtain is a girl with dark hair and blue eyes, like my wife Janine, or with light hair and dark eyes. That's a châtain. He said, Paul, I want you to listen to this. I want a special kind of female woman with a special kind of specifier. I want you to get me a female woman what weighs 75 on George, weighs just men, but I don't know if he said, wait, this is already specified. I want a female woman with 6'4" high, got red hair, and weighs 75 pounds. He said, I don't thought I'd get a woman with specified like that. My friend take a $50 bill out of his pocket, tear it in half, he hand half the boy, he say, you get the other half when you find one with better specified. Paul say, me, I'm gone. He's gone. About 30 minutes later, he called him on the phone. He said, look, I found a female woman. She don't quite meet you specify, but she's close, close, close. She don't quite meet 6'4", she just meet 6'3¾". She don't quite meet 75 pounds, she just meet 78 pounds. But red hairs, she broke out with that. My friends, they brought her up here. I cast one eye on that. Paul brought her up there, and my friend cast one eye. He said, that's close enough, Paul. Here's the other half of your $50 bill. Lost yourself. He lost himself. He said, baby, stood out there in the middle of that floor and took all your clothes from you and ran now. He stood out there in the middle of that floor and suit, and he called his little daughter Celestine, cute little red-haired girl, about 7 or 6 years old. He said, Celestine?
Yeah, Papa?
Brought yourself here.
Okay, Papa.
He said, Celestine, you see that female woman out in the middle of that floor like that?
Yeah, Papa.
That's the way you're gonna look if you don't drink your milk, I guarantee. That's close enough, we'll cover that.
Put it on a low, low fire. You see most all the juice has gone out of it? Can you see on it? See up there?
Hey.
It doesn't look funny? Take that like that. Now, come out of here, baby. Go on that like that and turn your fire down as low as you can get it. Say simmer, we're gonna put it on warm. You go out? Huh? We're gonna put it on simmer. Put it on simmer. Can you see that, Janine? It's on simmer. We got it on there? cheese? All right. Now we got something else we got to do. While we just let that cook, ordinarily we may drink a beer and relate our experiences in a gentleman-like manner and a lady-like manner to each other. But we got something else we got to do. He moved that over there like that. In this skillet over here, have I got everything I need there?
Yeah.
Philadelphia cream cheese. Pittsburgh and not Philadelphia?
This is Jitney Jungle.
Oh, Jitney Jungle cream cheese. Excuse me. All right. In 2 pounds, 4 8-ounce packages. Here's my spoon for that. I want to get the fire lit under it. That's what I need. It clicks and lets you know it's lighting something.
Mm. Oh, yeah. You got to melt this. It takes a little time. Go ahead on. Don't you read that lid. Oh, I'm glad we softened it a little. It's always a good idea to take this cream cheese out of your refrigerator about a couple hours before you put it in here because it's soften up easier and make itself melt more better. Now this is crab meat, hot crab meat dipped a la Gloria. She need not have up it. It's not good. Crab meat. We went to North Carolina and we went to this function they had up there and they had this hot crab meat dipped. It was good. She had in it. She told us a whole bunch of stuff. Before we came back, we added a little stuff to it, you know. Make it taste more better with a little cakes and seeds. And I want you to know it all good. Hot crab meat here. Come on, melt up here, cream cheese. Thank you.
that meat, you got that Philadelphia, you got the salt in it, you know. That Jimmy Jingle, Jim the Jungle, cream cheese. There we go. I think I'll put the pecans in it next. And 2 cups of pecans?
That's as much as you like.
It's just as much as you like, pecans. We like a lot of them. We put them in there. We mix it up. And we put a little salt in it. Salt to taste, ladies and gentlemen. There's no way to tell you how to salt this. Your pecans aren't salty. Your crab meat not salty. Your cream cheese may have a little salt in it. Sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to put 2 teaspoons full of salt. Just 2, no more. And that 2 teaspoons, you can bet your last little nickel. And you stir. Get it all mixed up together. You get it all mixed up together pretty good like that. You put a little down of hot sauce. I have no way to measure this except I know how much I'm putting in there. I'm going to put about 2 teaspoons full of this hot sauce in here. I would ordinarily, if I fixed it for me, I'd put a tablespoon full, which is 3 teaspoons full. See, I got my thumb now. I know about what I'm doing. Now, y'all may not think I do, but I do. Oh, man. Get together with that hot sauce. Now what you do, as you get this all mixed up, it's an hors d'oeuvre, you know, one of that nibbling food you get before you get people so they won't have too big an appetite when you ain't got enough to eat, you feed them this stuff, you know. You put this in a chafing dish and keep it hot. I'll tell you right now, they will eat it. Oh, that I know for sure. Oh, not quite ready. It should be ready, Janine. Try it. Hot sauce. You see there? And look, she's from the northern portion of the Louisiana Purchase, Montana. So we'll put that other teaspoon full of salt that I talked about. That's about that. We got a tablespoon full of hot sauce in here, what we have. But I'm not. I wish we had enough for everybody to taste this, but we don't have. I don't want to make anybody mad. I'm going to taste it, and Janine's going to taste it, and tell you all how good it is. symbol you need.
Tom symbol.
Jitney Jungle food stores. How about it, girls? Are we getting ready? Are we ready? I might add, too, that the Young at Heart Washboard Band, all made up of senior citizens, congratulations. Let's give them a big hand and a warm welcome. The Young at Heart Washboard Band from Philadelphia, Mississippi. Hit it, girls.
Thank you. and sneeze sweet snuff. It's the best snuff you ever have dipped. I recommend it. You see, we're selling sneeze sweet snuff. We're trying to get us some money to buy some band instruments. We just have to play old tubs and rub boards and sticks and stuff like that. We want some new instruments, so we want y'all to buy this sneeze sweet snuff. Before I started dipping sneeze sweet snuff, I just poorly all the time. Full arthritis hurt me. I just couldn't hardly go. I just grunted all the time, and I heard about this sneeze sweet snuff. You don't even have to spit. It's good stuff. You just dip it and then you just swallow it. You don't have to spit. Before I started dipping this stuff, I got a wooden leg. And that wooden leg just hurt me all the time. I just couldn't hardly go. So I started dipping this sweet snuff, and it's just been doing good all the time now. Don't have no trouble at all. Just keep a dipping sneeze sweet snuff. But now I got a problem. I have to tote a big knife around all the time. I take this knife around with me, and every once in a while I have to cut the sprouts off that wooden leg. Whether to say this or not, because this is a Piggly Wiggly company. I don't know where the Piggly Wiggly folks are, but if they would just stock this sneeze sweet snuff, y'all could get you some when you went by Piggly Wiggly store. So y'all buy some Piggly Wiggly, go by the Piggly Wiggly and see if they stock in sneeze sweet snuff and get you some of it. It's expensive. All they tell me is a gin in the jungle. No wonder. Gin in jungle stores might sell this sneeze sweet stuff. But I tell you what, if you'll buy it, we'll be standing back at the back. If y'all want to buy some when we go out, we'll take your money. But it'll do you good. I tell you, see, sneeze sweet stuff is a dip, it fits a lip. Thank you.
strong all the way from Neshoba County. I'm sure you played at the fair, ain't you? Thank you. We enjoyed that. And these little kids down front, if that doesn't tickle your heart. But let me tell you who these kids are. Thank you, ladies. That was a Young at Heart washboard band, and we really enjoyed that. Next, we have the Queen City Clockers from Meridian, Mississippi. 24 members strong. And they'll be on the floor down here, so you may have to, everybody keep seated so everyone in the back can see also. Let me tell you a little bit about these girls. They age...
And boys.
I'm sorry, partner. Excuse me. Yeah.
Both of you.
Yeah. They range in age from 4 to 14 years old. They have only been together now for 15 months. They have won the Mississippi Show and Novelty State Championship in Pascagoula. They have won the Jimmy Rogers Festival Team Championship in Meridian, and they have won the Junior Division Championship Hee Haw International Clogging Championship. Let's give them a big hand. This is the Queen City Cloggers from Meridian, Mississippi.
Lord, before I lose my mind.
tell you what, if you hadn't been here all day and seen all this entertainment, we've got them young and old and small and big. We've had a lot of entertainment today. And we